Welcome to the February 22nd, 2018 Oxford Preparatory Academy regular meeting of the Board of Directors. February 22nd, 2018, 5:30 closed session. It's obviously going to be delayed a little. 7 o'clock open session. We do plan to come back out at 7, even if we have to delay and go back into closed session at the end of the meeting. Meeting location is Oxford Preparatory Academy, Saddleback Valley Campus, 22882 Lamont Drive, Lake Forest, California, 92630. And teleconference location, Oxford Preparatory Academy, South Orange County Campus, 23000 via Santa Maria, Mission Viejo, California, 92691. The public attending, including public attending a teleconference location, are invited to address the board regarding items listed on the agenda. Comments on an agenda item will be accepted during consideration of that item or prior to consideration of the item in the case of a closed session item. Please turn in comment cards to the board secretary prior to the item you wish to speak on. Call to order, Raymond Jackson, treasurer.
Here.
Albert Diaz, secretary.
Here.
Joseph Haney, vice chair.
Here.
Sandra Garner, here. Pledge of Allegiance, Quinn Firmster?
Firmster.
I said, told you I was going to do that. First grade student from Saddleback. She's one of our performers tonight. She's going to lead us in the pledge. So all please rise.
Please stand and look at the flag and put your hand on your heart. Ready to begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Excellent job. Okay, we're going to go right into our student performance. We'll be doing the head table, get out of their way. A Chinese New Year celebration, Ms. Shana Lai, world language instructor. These are her students, so please enjoy it.
Hi, my name is Quinn. We have Washa Quinn Lane. I'm Ella. We have Washa Ella. We are in first grade. Woman Shah. Yin Chi. We are going to have a performance of the lion dance and the dragon and the ribbon dance. I love you.
Thank you.
Motion to approve the agenda for our regular board meeting for February 22nd, 2018.
Motion to approve. A second.
A second.
Freeman seconds.
Thank you. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Public announcement for reason of closed session for discussion and possible action, conference with legal counsel, potential litigation, government code 54956.9, subsection D, subsection 2, 3 cases. Conference with legal counsel, anticipated litigation, government code section 54956.9, subsection D, subsection 4, 1 case. Conference with legal counsel, existing litigation, government code section 54956.9, 5.9, subsection D, subsection 1, Oxford Preparatory Academy versus Chino Valley Unified School District, Oxford Preparatory Academy versus Enlightened Learning Solutions, and Public Employee Evaluation, Government Code Section 54957, subsection B for Chancellor and Dean. And the timeout is?
We have a speaker.
We do have a speaker, okay. Which campus?
Here,
it
would be here. Candy Reyes?
Okay, Candy.
Good evening, Board. Just wanted to speak on a couple of the items that are on closed session. You have the Chino appeal. You have the case against Ed Lighten. You have the case against Sue Roach. I would ask that the Board would somehow be able to share some items. I'm not asking for confidentiality, but quite a few parents from Chino are still asking what's going on. They thought our appeal was done. So they're wondering about that. They're also wondering about the case. Even if it's just to say, we're still in litigation with Sue, we're still in litigation with Ed Lighten, our appeal's still going. Everybody got that on the, because we're all, well, a lot of us are signed up. We all seen that something happened, but we don't know what. So I would ask that the Board share something out. SOC, when all the letters were going around, they came up and asked that something be shared out. Chino parents are asking that something be shared out also. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And
that's it.
Do you have any other speakers? Okay, what time?
5:55.
Okay, we're starting the closed session at 5:55. We'll be back at 7 o'clock. Okay, everyone, welcome back. It's 7:05. We are starting open session. We will be going back into closed session at the end of the meeting because we promised you we would be out here on time, and we're not done. So we will be going back in. But we do have one report out. In closed session, the Board approved the settlement for a special education student by a vote of 4-0 to resolve a special education dispute. The Board will be paying for educational services and attorney fees. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, when we're going to move on to our presentations. By the way, to YouTube land and SOC, we apologize. We were not live streaming before we went into a closed session because we did have a problem. I believe we did record it, though. And so I understand that everybody's back online.
And your microphone's going to get really close to you.
And I think we're back online. Okay. Okay, so moving to presentations, a Saddleback Valley site update, Garrett Bridges, Dean. And you'll also notice while you're coming up here, come on, you can come on up. We've repositioned the podium so that people who are watching from a different location is no longer getting this half view, so they'll see more of the face of the speaker at the podium. Okay? Okay.
I don't think anybody wants to see my face. All right, good evening. So we have about an 8-minute video that's going to give you a glimpse into what's been occurring since our last board update. In the video, you are going to see pictures of our Scholastic Book Fair, our 4th and 5th grade walkthroughs, National School Choice Week, my favorite day, dressed like a staff member day, our Honor Mod celebration, our Rise Against Hunger Day, where our 6th and 7th and 8th graders package food and meals for families in need. Our 8th grade performance of Frosty Follies, our Jingle Jam performance, 3rd grade Taekwondo board breaking ceremony, the start of our Mileage Club. I encourage you to come out in the mornings on Thursdays and run some miles, and SOC versus Saddleback Valley basketball games, and our International Day celebration that happened last week.
Okay, thank you.
All right, this one works. So some upcoming things, and hopefully the next board update for Saddleback Valley, you'll see our Chinese New Year celebration that we had this week.
Awesome.
Today we actually had our 6th grade walkthrough. Our open enrollment period is coming to an end. So our lottery will be in April, and spring break is coming. So we are super excited for spring break.
What can you tell us about the Willy Wonka back here? Beautiful decorations.
So tomorrow we have OPA Awards, and our 2nd graders are going to perform some songs and some scenes from Willy Wonka. So I'm hoping that there is real candy, and there's not. So we're excited to see the performance tomorrow.
Well, great job, Saddleback Valley. Wow. Thank you very much. Mr. Bridges. Now we're going to move to what does the charter say, and I think that Dean Boucher is going to do the presentation on this.
Where'd he go?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
All right, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about some verbiage that's in our charter. It's in element one, and the section I'm going to talk about is what does it mean to be an educated person in the 21st century, and OPA's belief in that. So we believe that to truly be an educated learner in the 21st century, one needs to possess a certain set of skills and attributes. Nine of them are highlighted in our charter. The nine are high academic proficiency, communication skills, research skills, technological proficiency, interpersonal skills, intrapersonal skills, innovation, tolerance, and curiosity. We've taken those skills among many others and embedded them throughout our program in a multitude of ways. The charter also highlights some of those, so I'm going to talk about some of those. The first way that the students are able to express themselves and practice these skills is through collaborative projects in the classroom, on the playground. Another way is through MI activities. So you will see those taking place within the classroom. They also take place during clubs and different things that take place on campus. So those MI activities include, for example, here's a spatial game board that's taking place. So the students are learning to work together. A lot of the time, those MI activities will also be practicing their interpersonal skills along with the intrapersonal skills. You can also, the students can also practice those skills using technology in the classroom. We are one-to-one Chromebooks down to second grade. Our first graders do share a Chromebook cart, and we also have a Chromebook cart in kindergarten, which is very exciting. They also see the computer lab too. So they're using technology a lot in the classroom, and I know our teachers are always coming up with new ways to use technology in the classroom, which is very exciting. We also have project-based learning taking place in the classroom. This is where students are really diving into real-world scenarios, real-world situations that they may face as adults or teenagers or even children now, and they're working collaboratively to solve those problems, discuss those problems, and just really come up with solutions to them. We saw one tonight, but they also practice those 21st century learning attributes and skills through performances and in our extracurricular clubs. We have over 20 clubs here on campus, including a kindness club, which is shown there in the picture, before and after school sports, a strings program, which is very exciting, put on by Mr. Sachs, our music teacher. And so Oxford Prep will continue to promote the four C's of 21st century learning, which is critical thinking, collaboration, creativity, and communication. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, under presentations, we're now going to move to our advisory council update, Saddleback Valley Campus.
Hello.
Hello.
Nothing much to update. We didn't meet in the month of February. We've planned a joint meeting, and due to some scheduling due to some scheduling conflicts, that one didn't happen. But we have our next meeting coming up on March 8th, and the biggest focus on that one is just getting our final approval on our Mimio smart boards that will hopefully be in every single classroom. So I think that kind of connects and ties in directly with what Mrs. Boucher was saying, which is extremely exciting. And then also Mr. Barley and myself have been working together to get our joint date for our joint advisory council meeting, and it's looking like that will be on March 14th. So we're really excited for that and looking forward to working with them and having that collaboration across both campuses with both advisory councils. And lastly, our next focus is looking at the LCAP.
Right.
So that is our update.
Excellent, thank you. Advisory Council update, South Orange County campus.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Is this the one?
Yeah.
Okay. as Mr. Treba said, we have confirmed March 14th for the Joint Advisory Council meeting, so we're excited about that. And yesterday we had an Advisory Council meeting that Dr. Hall and Kathleen Doherty attended, so that was a productive meeting. We worked on the English learner policy, which I think is something that the board's looking at tonight, mm-hmm. as well as LCAP. So we have a plan and we've made some progress in a very productive meeting. So we were thrilled about that. And the council was thrilled, as our constituents were in the office and in the audience yesterday, about the progress that's being made at the board level. You know, the promises and the things that have been discussed for a long time, it really does seem like action is taking place. So enough words, and now it's time for action. So we're all very thrilled and excited about that and your commitment for that going forward. So thank you.
Thank you. Okay, comments from the board of directors. Let's go ahead and start with Mr. Haney.
Oh, I got to go first. I wasn't quite prepared for that, but that's okay. Nothing really, but I was just really impressed. Other than it was really exciting to get to see the performance earlier from the kids. That was above and beyond what you expect as a parent and as a board member. It's a source of tremendous pride. And I sat there and snapped a couple of pictures because that's why we're up here, because we want to be able to see an education environment where kids get to experience that level and depth and substance of learning. So to the SE staff and teachers that are here, good job. Appreciate that. That was amazing to watch.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Diaz?
Well, love the performances, always do. 2 nights ago, I was here for the what we call it, Roundtable 2.0, and it was fantastic. I loved walking around, looking at all the different comments and the good, the bad, the things that people want to see in the future. It was Justin Timberlake was here as well. He's sitting there in the back. I saw a lot of things that that we've heard before. I saw a lot of things that I'd never really even thought of. So it was good to see that, and I'm looking forward to seeing the combined list.
Okay, and Mr. Jackson.
Thank you very much. I would just like to thank everybody who is here, everybody who's in YouTube Landia, everybody at SOC, for really supporting Kathleen. So she's been here for just a few short weeks. She's got both oars in the water and she's rowing hard. And I know sometimes it seems like it's tough to say the same thing that you said last month again to a new face, but I appreciate you doing that. I appreciate you being willing to bring her up to speed. She's coming up to speed very, very quickly, and I think we can all feel her presence. And so I appreciate all that you guys are doing to make sure that we stay on track. I really appreciate Kathleen being here, my board mates for embracing kind of this new regimen, the way we do things. And Kathleen, as you know, has an incredible amount of experience, not just as an ED, but as a superintendent. And so she comes to us with sort of a lot of really great advice about how we ought to be doing things and how we need to perform as a board. And so thank you to my board mates for accommodating all the newness in this. That said, Chase, I'm getting a lot of feedback from people that are having different experiences tonight than they have AV-wise. Does SOC have a microphone?
No.
Okay. And can they see and hear us in the presentations and the...
Yes.
And they can see the video of the people and they can also see the presentations?
They're saying no.
They can hear us.
Okay, they can do sign language. All right, well, we got a little bit to work on there, but... Because I'm getting feedback from family members at home as well, saying that they can hear, and then sometimes they can hear and not see. So anyway, thank you for continuing to work on that.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Jackson. There's a few issues that I want to talk about. First of all, I want to thank all of the parents and teachers who participated in the ED survey. It goes on for pages and pages and pages, and I think we have a lot of good information. We have a lot of opportunities for input on selecting our new ED. So I want to thank you for participating. The same thing with the Town Hall 2.0. Mr. Haney and I attended the SOC. Mr. Diaz and Mr. Jackson attended the Saddleback Valley. So we had board participation, and it was really exciting to see everyone engaged, and I think that they were very pleased with the outcome. I know that we were. We now have our marching orders, and that's exactly what we were looking for. Also, considering the safety issues, I know with the recent events in Parkland, Florida, that always brings that back to the forefront of our minds, and we need to keep it there. But I just want to let you know that both campuses are very proactive. They're looking into everything possible to make sure that we're doing everything possible. But one of the things that I would like to suggest, if the advisory councils will take this into their consideration, one of the reasons why we put the advisory councils together was for you to really be dealing with your site-specific issues, and one of those is safety. You're closer to the campus than we are. And so I would like to at least recommend that maybe you might want to consider putting together an ad hoc committee. I'm sure that in your communities you have a lot of safety professionals and experts, maybe who can really help with this issue and bring back to the board, you know, your concerns and solutions. But I think that that would be a real good idea. And as I hear from parents, I'll pass them on and suggest that maybe they contact you, because I'm already hearing from parents we want to get involved. You know, we really need to make sure we're doing everything that we can to keep our children safe. So I think the advisory councils can play a really an important role here. Okay. Okay, great. Okay, we've talked a lot about Mrs. Darty here. For those of you who don't know her, she's the interim executive director, and as Mr. Jackson said, we are so blessed to have her and her leadership. She has a lot of experience under her belt, and she'll make sure that we stay in line and we know what we're doing too. And so that's great. And so it's now time for her report. Mrs. Darty.
Thank you. I just wanted to respond to the speaker who came forward for our closed session piece and say that we do understand that everybody remains interested, not just the Chino folks, but everybody is interested in the appeal. And we want to make sure that we can provide you information that is appropriate and not privileged. And so what we want to share with you right this second is that we continue to move forward with the appeal of the Superior Court's denial. Our writ petition regarding the OPA CV renewal petition, it is moving forward, and the court appeal at this point, Oxford has filed its opening brief, and the VUSD has recently filed a response regarding that, and we are now preparing our reply. I do want you to know that we're going to keep you updated on information as we can, so you should plan on hearing an update at each board meeting, so you know where we are at in the process and when we will hope to bring it to a conclusion. The other things that I kind of wanted to share, this community has been so wonderful about just opening up, and I love it. I feel very comfortable here. I do live in Placer County, and I love it up there because my husband's up there, but you know, if there was a way that we could be in two places always, this is an area that I certainly would come to. We did, and I love the input that I'm getting from parents, so please keep continuing to connect with me, and I will do my very best to meet with you when I'm down here. I am only down here 10 days a month right now, and this is my eighth day, so I just want to put that in perspective as we look at what we're trying to accomplish. We got a letter from a parent, and I was appreciative to receive that letter, and he was a concerned parent of an SOC, of the SOC campus, and wanted to make sure that in light of the recent events that we were doing what we were supposed to be doing. So I want to make sure everyone is aware. Both campuses have taken immediate action to start practicing the information that is in their safety plans. And one of the things that I got to do was observe the SOC lockdown drill yesterday, and I know that SV also had a lockdown drill yesterday. I know that our first responders participated in those drills, and we had the luxury of also having a very knowledgeable parent walk around with us, and I made the comment to him, so what can you fix? Not that they have to fix it, but just giving that feedback is so very, very important, because you as a community bring such information and input and skill sets to us. So we want to make sure that we're using your knowledge and skills. Both the campuses are now working on revisiting and revising their safety plans. Both of the campuses are working with the advisory councils will be working with the admin from each site to redevelop, but also with the local responders to make sure that we're doing the best thing we can to look at the training of the staff, to look at the safety of the students, and to look at the gaps in our site campuses and see what we can do to work with our authorizers to remove those. We did have two great town hall meetings. Again, the one thing I appreciate about this community is there is no lack of vocalizing how you feel. I think that's great. And they were both very positive, and I appreciate that because sometimes it's easy to switch to the negative and you forget to say, here's where I want to go. So I really appreciate that. What we're going to do is take that information, merge it together in one document so that the board has its marching orders, as Mrs. Garner talked about, but also to separate it out and keep it separate to move toward each of the campuses so the campuses can start looking at the desires and concerns of the parents and move in that direction as well. We're also going to use some of this information for the LCAP. I had the just pleasure, I think, is I can't explain it any other way. It's like attending a conference that you've been waiting for a long time, or a concert, really, some famous person on stage, and I got to attend the International Day and was just totally blown away. And the food was good, too. But I also got to see student performances that day. Today, I got to see the sixth grade walkthrough, an amazing piece, and those kids were so stoked to earn those points. So I hope that they did earn the certificate, and they work for points for certificates, which is even better. It's like, and you're going to get a certificate. It's like, yay! So that was really fun. I also got to participate in my second parent information meeting, the PIM. When I came down my very first time, I was able to observe the PIM over at SOC, and it was really nice to visit the one here that happened last night. From a board perspective, the ad hoc committee interviewed potential board candidates. You are going to hear from two finalists tonight, and the board will take action on the 13th to select and appoint a new board member. So we are very excited about that as well, just moving very quickly. And I had somebody once tell me that I need to stop moving at warp speed, and I guess I don't know what warp speed is, but I'm excited that everybody is just staying up with me. I see the energy, I see the passion with everyone, and I am so happy to be a part of it. So thank you very much.
Okay, moving on to comments from the audience on items not on the agenda. The public, including public attending a teleconference location, are invited to address the board regarding items not listed on the agenda. No individual presentation shall be for more than 3 minutes, and the total time for this purpose shall not exceed 15 minutes. Ordinarily, board members will not respond to presentations and no action can be taken. However, the board may give direction to staff following a presentation. Please turn your comment card into the board secretary prior to the agenda item. I understand we have one speaker who is not speaking to an agenda item.
Correct.
Is that correct? Okay. Mm-hmm.
Candy Reyes.
This one?
Yes, please.
First, welcome, Ms. Daugherty. I'm very excited for what you are going to bring to OPA, and hopefully there'll be some stability. Last board meeting, there was comments made to the time study that was done on the OPA employees.
Candy, can you just get a little closer to that microphone?
I'd like to say that you can never overpay a great teacher, and OPA is complete with all of our teachers. They are taught very with our program, and they are all outstanding teachers. So I, for one, do say they need to be paid more, if, you know, with our budget allowing. But I wanted to address Dave from the advisory council from SOC made the comment on the time study that it was an unnecessary hurdle and it was a demotivator. But in the same sentence, he said that they thought that the time study was for a small subject of shared employees. Well, doesn't those two same demotivators and unnecessary hurdle apply to those shared employees? the small set of shared employees who keep being referred to as Chino employees at town hall meetings, at board meetings, even from our chartering agencies. Are Chino employees being singled out? This has got to stop. I haven't spoken. I've stayed silent. No more. I worked at Chino. I was one of the original people who started in 2008 to start this for children to make a difference. I gave up my life, as many people here did. Their families, their marriages, their children went to the side to make Oprah great. I digress. I think we need to have unity. Stop with the his and hers and us against them. We're a family. And last time I checked, I may disagree with my family, but they're still my family and I'll stand up for them. I ask your attorney, look up the word discrimination. Are Chino employees being discriminated against when their names are being brought up and put in writing? When my name, when I'm applying for jobs and I'm being asked, oh, are you associated with this? That shouldn't be. Our name should not be put out there. You all work at jobs. You're not referred to by where you live. Employees should be looked at for their job performance, not on your last name, not on who you worked for previously. Jackson, I want to thank you. I want to thank you for your comments. I'm sorry, Mr. Jackson. Thank you. Quoted there. I do believe the purpose was going from three
time
to two. Can I? Was going from three campuses to two campuses. I thank you for recognizing that OPA has awesome employees. If the true purpose was to ensure that we are spending money in the best way, then yes, all personnel outside of the classroom should have been included in the time study to ensure that our money is being spent wisely. And I love your word, and I'm going to say it. I tried to say it with you, Mr. Diaz. Superfluously. As we are reorganizing our organization, can we please respect all of our employees and not single out any group?
Okay, Mrs. Reyes, time is up. Thank you.
I'm going to put this in writing.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, I think that was the only comments that were
correct.
Not on the agenda. So we're going to move into, I think we have two other people who want to speak, but they will speak when we get to the agenda item.
Correct.
Okay, so don't go away. Items for information, Gilbert and Associates, August Review, Dr. Lisa Hall.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. And this is an information item. Our board does have it's up on the screen, and our board has it in their packet, and it is available online. This is Gilbert and Associates review from the month ending August 31st. And it was a clean audit in the areas of attendance, payroll, disbursements, receipts, all the reviews of statement of activities by school in comparison to the board approval budgets. There were no variations found, and they reviewed 25 random expenditures for all schools, including payroll transactions, and they verified that there was nothing to be worried about. And the results are essentially that there are no significant concerns in any area. No related party transactions were identified to us by management, is what they stated. And they enjoy working with us. And in their next report, you'll have 2 months. So it will be September and October.
Dr. Hall, I notice it says it no significant concerns, but out of curiosity, do they ever raise any concerns that just don't rise to the level of being significant?
They haven't raised any concerns. They haven't questioned anything where we've had to submit additional backup.
Okay.
So I haven't seen any.
If I could just add on to that, having dealt with audits over the years, they always
they always raise concerns, and they may not put it in paper, but it will be in their report to the board. So even if it's a minor concern or make a comment on something that has been changed. So if they did not make any in this particular instance, that means it was a very clean audit.
Good.
But they've made they originally had, mm-hmm. during their initial reviews had said, hey, we'd like you to start doing this and we'd like you to start doing that. So
you've done a lot of work.
Exchanged a fair amount of recommendations that we've implemented.
Right. They gave us some procedural things and processes that they would like to see different or documented that we hadn't documented. I think we got that in our first two reports, and ever since then they've been happy with our internal controls and our processes and procedures.
Okay.
SOC renewal timeline, Mrs. Darty.
So this is an informational piece we are putting together, and what we're going to be doing is, do you have that?
Oh.
There it is. We're going to be starting our renewal process right away. We're going to be taking the processes that have been used in the past and kind of merge them into processes that are being currently used across all charters, and identify a committee to work on it. And the committee is going to be made up of representatives from the SOC campus and also some experienced charter writers from the SV campus and those who have gone through the process before. We are going to be meeting with our authorizer to make sure that this timeline meets with their requirements, because this is an early renewal process. We're hoping to have it taken care of by June. It could be delayed, but the requirements for the renewal from our authorizers is actually November. So the sooner we can get this taken care of, the better, and the comfort level for all is my feeling at this point in time. So this is, again, just this draft. We're going to be identifying our committee. We'll be reviewing the current charter and then soliciting input from the parents and staff, taking a look at the components of the charter to see if there's anything that we might want to tweak a little bit, remembering that we are still operating around the concept of OPA and the OPA philosophy, but we might be taking some input that will either can be adjusted and adapted for on the campus, or maybe something that we didn't think about as a group. We're going to be reviewing the renewal criteria, and because I've done renewals as an authorizer, I'm going to be using the forms that I use to do oversight and or review renewals from the charters that were within my district, and also those from districts who have asked me to help support them in renewing their charters. So it's pretty up to date, and it has the quality criteria, and we will literally take a look at every component of that and make sure our charter has those pieces in it. And since they have a rating scale on whether it's excellent, it's acceptable, or it's not acceptable, we'll make sure that our charter is in the excellent area. We are going to be updating the current petition with number 2 or 3 above in the timeline by that is hoped for by April, and I know that sounds really quick, but I think if we put our minds to it and work together collaboratively, we can get it done. When we update the petition, I need to change my vision here. We're going to be reviewing the LCAP pieces too, because now we're required for charter renewals to embed LCAP into the charter petition. Thank you. Still need my glasses. Okay. And then we're going to take a look and make sure that everything is in place and see if we're missing any components. And we should have the basic almost complete draft done by May 4th. We have to embed assessment, and that assessment has to look like enrollment, attendance, and demographic data. And we're going to have that tentatively there by the 4th, but those may need to be changed based on when we submit and any new data that we get. And then we're going to be presenting it to the advisory council, who is going to be participating with us, but for final review. Please keep in mind that every step of the way we will be bringing this information back to the board for their review as well, and we're going to be working with legal counsel and CCSA for each piece and part. and then we'll do one final review with legal before we present it to the OPA board for final approval and send it forward. Again, we're going to be working hand in hand with Capo. I like those long A's, with Capo, because we want to make sure that we're doing it exactly as they want it. But again, our intent is to move forward as a team and get it done as a team and make sure that we're not missing out on anything. So this list looks like it's pretty comprehensive. It really is not. It's pretty basic. The timeline is draft, and dates and times change based on input that we get and recommendations that we get. But our overall goal is to have this submitted no later than June.
Any questions? Okay. We're going to move on to the certificated salary study update. Mrs. Darty?
I apologize. We didn't have the speaker to speak on the...
Oh, we need to speak. Okay.
I apologize.
Charter renewal, we do have a speaker?
We do. It's Candy Reyes.
Candy?
Okay, so I've never spoken. I'm just getting it all done in 1 minute.
Okay.
As you guys are... First, I have to say I visited the South Orange County campus and was able to... One of the teachers had invited me to come and see their amazing journal entries. And amazing work's being done on our campuses. Amazing work's being done by our teachers. And he had a class full of kids who were raising their hand. Everybody wanted to participate in reading their journal. And that's part of our antecedents of excellence, because not everybody can get up here and speak behind a microphone. So I love that they're continuing our OPA program. And I just want to shout out Mr. Ann. Yay, you did a great job. As you are working on the charter renewal, I would ask that the board, as they're working with whoever they're going to be working with, that we keep the charter renewal and that we keep our OPA program. Mr. Haney, you made remarks when we did our Chino, and you told our Chino parents that we needed to start their own charter. I conclude myself as a Chino parent because my grandchild goes there, or find a charter to sponsor them. Well, just for information, this is our Chino charter, and we graciously brought it to the South Orange County campus. So I'd like to remember that this was a phenomenal program. It's not Sue Roach. It's the time everybody took to write this. It's decades of teaching experience. It wasn't just her. Our program is number one for a reason. Someone, a past person who worked here, told me our charter is not special. I'm sorry, I beg to differ. If you can show me another charter that is number one and can compete with district schools, I think we're pretty good. I think our teachers are awesome. I think our parents are awesome. I think we have a lot to offer. I just hope that we keep our program. Don't be quick to change it. Nick from the SOC campus shared something that we needed to update our requirements, by all means. Our science, we're behind the times. We never brought up. There's other things that our current people who are working here who have plenty to offer. Adding to it, please just do not take it away. There are certain people that think certain programs are a waste of time. Please look at everything thoroughly. And before you make any changes, talk to the people that are teaching this. I see up there that we want to take parents, and I love the staff, but from parents, if you're not in the classroom, and if you haven't read the charter, I don't know how much input you can have that's effective and follows our OPA program. I just ask, keep our OPA program. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a speaker for the salary.
We do. Pam Thompson.
Pam Thompson.
Is she possibly...
I told everybody not to go home.
Is she possibly at SOC?
Sure.
SOC. They haven't texted me, but...
Okay.
She was here earlier. She was here.
SOC doesn't have a microphone.
Well, they
could turn it on, but
we can
but
get them.
He just confirmed they're not there. She's not there.
No, not there.
Was that a no?
I think that was a no. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. So that was the last of our speakers for the evening.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
I think yes. So.
Okay, so now we will move into the certificated salary study update with Mrs. Darty.
Thank you. So one of the things that I wanted to do is address the concern that our staff is not paid enough and that our salary schedule is a little bit
weird. And it actually is very weird, but that's okay. We've done an initial study, and there is an Excel spreadsheet if you're interested in taking a look at it. It is posted up there. A little bit hard to understand, but we took a look at, let's see if I can find it.
Do you guys have this?
Okay. There should be two sheets to it, but the first thing we did is we took a look at surrounding districts. One of the things that I want to make sure everybody understands is that when we start getting comps from charters are notoriously not high paying in the range of salary typically for their certificated classified employees. And they also are very private about that, even though that's public information. So we haven't been able to obtain the kind of information we need from charters. But what I did do is I got the comparisons from 11 surrounding districts, including Irvine, because there seemed to be a lot of concern about what was going on at Irvine. And you can't compare annual salaries to annual salaries because the requirements for the salaries are different in each district. Some teachers' contracts are 184 days, some are 185, some are 186, ours is 190. And the second thing you can't do is necessarily take a look at the comparison exactly of the ranges because there's different criteria. Some districts will pay a flat fee if you don't have a clear credential. Some districts are paying an intern salary. Some districts will pay every 15 units. Some give a stipend for master's degree. Others build it into the salary. So it's that piece. So what I did was I went with what we could look at, which is daily salary, and I converted, or actually my son did because he owes me, but I converted all of the annual salaries into daily salaries, and I also put down, when you're looking at the districts, I also put down the categories that they pay, so you can kind of see a little bit, and that's on the first sheet. And then I took a look at ours, and the one thing I noticed about ours is that the certificated salary schedule is built on a flat fee, and then it has embedded into the salary $1,500 for extra duty stipends, and that's very, very unusual. And I felt that because of that, what I needed to do was subtract the $1,500 to get the base salary. So if you take a look at the next page.
So the salary numbers would be overstated.
Yes, and they are overstated. If you take a look at the next page, what I did do you have that? Can you flip it? Who's doing it?
Chase is doing it.
Sheet two. Does he need a go to sheet two. There we go. Can you make that bigger? Okay. So if you take a look at sheet two now, what you're going to see is the district listed by name, just the number of days, the range in step one, which is first year, from high to low, low to high, the range in step 10, because you don't have to compare each one, and most of the districts around here go up to about 20 years of service. I don't have entry level requirements, but I don't know that we actually need those to start our discussions. And then the range in step 20 to 27, and that's where some districts stop at step 20, some stop at 27. And then I highlighted two districts, and then at the very bottom I highlighted OPA because I wanted you to be able to see the one I don't have is Saddleback, and it's interesting because Saddleback wasn't giving us much information. But I can put Saddleback on here as well, and their numbers are going to be similar. So what you see is Capistrano, which is our SOC authorizer. You're going to see Irvine, which is our next door neighbor and everybody's really worried about. And then you'll see what I kind of considered surrounding, even though I know Huntington Beach is about 25 minutes away or 25 miles away in about an hour and a half. But Fountain Valley, which has a student population similar to some of the students that we draw from, tried to compare apples to apples instead of every other thing. And what I want you to take a look at and where I want to start our discussions is the fact that we have 190 days. We are the only school organization within this range that has 190 days. Some of the charters do too, some of the other ones, and I have other information I'll bring forward on them. But the range from low to high for us is 254 to 288 for step one, and we are the bottom half there. I just want to bring that up. So I'm acknowledging that you guys are right. That's probably going, yeah, we told you so, why didn't you believe us? But the reality is sometimes you need data to say, this is our stepping off point, this is where we're going to start. Step 10, which is 307 to 421, and step 27, which is 356 to 481. So here I've just got your daily rates as a comparison, because now we're actually looking at what are other districts paying their teachers. Our average teacher salary is $59,000. That is our average teacher salary here. And by that I mean I didn't take the salary schedule and add the numbers and divide. What I did was I took your salaries from payroll and divided it to get your average teacher salary. So your average teacher salary is $59,600, $59,700, something like that. And that includes the $1,500. So we can subtract $1,500 from that, so your average teacher salary is really about $5,700 or $5,750. I think we have a good jumping off point. And what I am recommending and would like to do is that I form a committee. I do love committees, and I do think they're very valuable. But form a committee of two teacher representatives from each site and the admin from each site, and I will let the teachers pick their own representatives. I don't, you know who you want to represent you, and we're going to have those discussions. What you don't see listed here is the second part of this, which you also think about when you talk about compensation. You talk about total compensation, and total compensation includes your benefit package. Your benefit package is actually a very good benefit package, and it's very competitive with everybody else, but it needs to be embedded into the equation, so we're going to be looking at that as well. And what my goal is to have those discussions, to come up with a fair and equitable salary for the certificated staff, to put together a new salary schedule that's based on I think some similar criteria than what our current one has been based on, that isn't based on the assignment that you get, but rather what you bring to the job, because all other salary schedules are like that. And then your assignment itself will dictate what range you're in. And then bring that forward probably by May, because we have to be able to embed that into the budget that we're developing for next year. We're still looking at budget items for this year, but if we're mindful about what we need and what we want, we can embed those kinds of things into the budget and make it work for us, and I'm confident that we can. One of the things that I also noticed is we don't have an administrative salary schedule. It's kind of hit or miss. So my next target will be to do the administrative salary schedule. So if you go back and you take a look at the first Excel file I showed you, I included administrative salaries for all of those same districts, because we really need to see what are people in similar positions getting paid. And here I also included the enrollment of the district as well, so that we can see what we're doing and how we're doing it and make sense of it. The last thing, and I'll be brief because I know I talk too long, is we don't have a non-certificated, non-administrative salary schedule. And so we are going to put one of those together too. And we're going to be doing that for, again, May. Those are a little easier to do because they're not based on tenure, or not tenure, but they're not based on degree and units. It's pretty much a flat fee, so it's just based on service years, and then we'll go from there. So that's my plan. This is information only. Just wanted you to know that we've already started it, and when I made the comment at Town Hall, you don't have to vote for this because we're on it, but now I feel like I've accomplished one of the dots, because we're there, and we're not there yet, but we'll keep going, again, with that goal to be finished by May, when we adopt our LCAP, when we are adopting our budget in June, and when we're moving forward. Okay.
Can I ask a question before Joseph?
Oh.
You were quick. Yeah. I had it primed. I was ready. But
yep.
All right.
Yep. You're the first.
I saw him goosing up to the microphone. I saw. Kathleen, first of all, thank you very much for this thoughtful inquiry. This is awesome. And this dialogue has needed to happen, and I'm very happy that it's happening. Would it be okay for us to put some sort of milestones in there? So I heard the May date, which is awesome. So I'm imagining that between now and May, so maybe like we're going to form this compensation committee that you talked about. We're going to identify those folks at each campus who are going to participate, have those initial meetings set up to go through, because I feel like a lot of analysis has happened already, and at that committee level, they can present that, you know, that will be very helpful, right? So what I'd love to see, if we can, is some milestones to say, how do we, if May's kind of the, we got a final answer in May.
Well, May is when I'll be bringing it to the board for approval.
Love it.
Yeah, so, and I so I backwards map.
Okay, great. Let's
so,
do it.
Yeah, so we'll do that. I will be putting out a letter to both staff mm-hmm. at both sites to say, send me your two nicest people. No, send me two that you want to be on this committee, because we will take a look at all of this. They will have homework to do, and we will meet, but I plan to do an update at every meeting.
Got it. And so would it be okay for us to say, what would be safe to say then, you're going to have at least one meeting between now and the next, with that committee, they'll be formed and have a meeting before our next board meeting? Oh, maybe not, because we're doing it on the 13th, huh?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I think it would be safe to say, though, I will.
Ooh, I love it. I love it.
And you don't have reason to doubt
Jennifer,
this.
Can we scribble that down there? Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I believe in getting things done.
Love it.
Are you done, Mr. Jackson?
I'm done, Mr. Joseph.
Thank you. So my question is, in interpreting this data, if I look at it and say Irvine at the low end for a step one is 305 and OPA at the low end is 254, there's a $51 per day difference. So if I multiply that out by the number of days that our teachers are working, that's about a $9,700 difference at the low end. Is that how I'm supposed to interpret this?
No, because I've already done the division of 190 days.
Okay.
So that reflects that 190 days is the daily rate.
Okay.
So take 5 days out.
So take 5 days out. Okay. But it's still a pretty significant number if I swap that out for 180.
Do 5 times 250.
Yeah, it's around 5,000.
Yeah, it looks like a range between 5,000 and 9,500 depending on each district.
But depending upon each district, we're at the bottom half again, and I was real disappointed to see that. But we will make it right.
Good.
And one of the things that, you know, I met with our authorizer from this campus, Kelly, today, and just had a great meeting with her. And one of the things that we talked about was that this was coming forward, and our concern about the fact that charter schools are often underpaid. And very concerned about that, and different levels of staffing is underpaid. So I did tell her that I would be working on it, and I do bring a district perspective to it. But I'm also very mindful about budget, and I've never had a qualified or negative budget during my 15 years as a superintendent. And I plan to make sure that we don't have the same.
But the numbers are sobering. I mean, it's really good stuff to see, because it's...
They are, but a lot of this has to do with the way our salary schedule is set up, and we need to start with the organization of the salary schedule first, reorganize, and then come back and revisit what that looks like.
So the cavalry's coming. Hold tight.
And thank you for including teacher representatives from both campuses. I know that they will really appreciate having input. Okay, any other questions regarding certificated salary schedules?
But they have to be nice. Is that a condition?
I was joking. I'm used to working with some...
How about nice hair?
...hostile negotiating teams, so this is going to be a pleasure because we know we're moving up.
Okay, governance committee update. Mr. Haney, do we have an update?
We do not.
Okay. Finance audit committee update. Mr. Jackson, do we have an update?
Oh my gosh, we have awesome candidates. Thank you, whoever sent that out but didn't tell me it was going out. Thank you very much for that.
A little help from your friends.
A little help from my invisible, unknown, unforecasted friends has resulted in quite a response for audit committee folks. So I think this will be the last time that we don't have a good update.
Okay, good.
Which will be good because we have a nice audit to look at over the next 60 days, too. So.
Right. Okay. And we're moving on then to the nominating committee report and candidate statement interviews. We have both of the recommended candidates with us tonight. Mrs. Daugherty, would you like to take the lead on this?
I would like to do that. Thank you very much. Again, I already kind of gave in my executive director's report. The ad hoc committee had a very difficult decision. We had absolutely outstanding candidates, and I am honored to ask both Priscilla and Joshua to come forward at this time, please.
And the nominating committee, I'd like them to do a report out. So after they do their presentation, we ask any questions that we want. If the two of you want to add anything as the nominating committee, that would be the appropriate time. Okay.
So these are the two candidates for the one open position that we have right now. And the process that we will use is they are each going to make a candidate statement, tell you a little bit about themselves. Yeah. And why they want to be on the board as the fifth person and represent the entire community. Because remember, as an open board, you represent the entire community. And then the board is going to have an opportunity to ask them questions. And they didn't do their homework, I have to say, because I only got... Okay. Anyway, they are going to ask questions. They're not going to ask duplicate questions, but just more questions about, you know, information and what they can bring to the board. The board is not going to vote tonight. Again, they will vote and appoint on March 13th at the beginning of the meeting. And this gives us time to do a little bit of a deliberation and then move forward with that. So with that, which one of you drew the lucky number one?
I don't think we decided.
You didn't decide it?
You go right ahead, ladies first.
Ladies first.
And we're not going to have a timer on you.
Okay, good.
Isn't that great?
That's perfect.
And if I could just pretty please ask, yep, microphone, perfect. Tammy, can you help her adjust that? Pretty please.
Yeah. She's doing great.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good evening, everybody. It's an honor for me to be here tonight. It is no longer good enough to memorize your mathematic equation or to speak back facts about the Revolutionary War. No. Education is about finding a way to learn and helping those around you to discover their own vision, mission in today's society. Education is a shared commitment between dedicated teachers, motivated students, and enthusiastic parents with high expectation. But most of all, educational leadership is about empowering others to be the best that they can be. As an active parent and proud member of our community, I am committed to I'm committed to making our schools exceptional. Education is my passion. For those of you who know me, you know that. I want to help mend the fences that have been broken in our community, to restore trust and integrity where it's needed. I believe and value our OPA program, its vision, and its mission. Throughout my career, I have worked with many different people, different personality, and I have always managed to deliver the highest quality service. I am committed to listening first, to leading thoughtfully and respectfully, and to building strong partnership to find the best solution for our children and OPA. I have extensive professional experience in the field of education, both in leadership and in the classroom. And I also have a background in social work, customer service, and public relations. I will bring to the board a different set of skills, particularly analytical thinking, strategic development, and data analysis. I am also very familiar with the management procedures, such as financial processes, budget, conflict of interest, parliamentarian procedures, since I was the parliamentarian for Honor Society, and I had to learn fast, Brown Act, and charter schools, operation, and governance. If selected, my effort as a board member would center on serving all children, modeling effective and operational policies, as well as use my professional background to build upon the contributions of our current board members and bring forth a fresh, energetic perspective and work collaboratively with the entire OPAC community to provide the solutions-oriented leadership necessary to develop and implement a vision for our schools that preserve the best of our past and prepare us for the future. And like Carl Rogers said, the only person who is educated is the one who has learned how to learn and change. Thank you.
Thank you. And can you just share with us what school you're from? What school?
From SOC.
Thank you very much.
Sorry.
That's okay.
And when do we get to ask questions? After?
After
their statements.
Hi, good evening. Thank you, members of the board, for the opportunity to be here with you tonight and tell you a little bit about myself. Let me start by saying the reason that I am interested in serving on the board of OPA is totally selfish reasons. Two of them. Elijah is about 6 years old. Edison is about 4 years old. Elijah is a kindergartner at the SOC campus. Mrs. DeVito's his teacher. Loves it. Loves her. She's amazing. Edison, obviously, he'll be going there eventually. I am entirely invested in making sure that those two little boys and all their little friends have an amazing educational experience. And the only way that I can help to do that is by possibly serving on this board, providing some insight. I've got a decent amount of experience serving on boards. I'm a business person. I've got my own business. I've got an analytical mind. It's just what I do. I'm an accountant. I've got a skeptical mind. I don't have a lot of history with OPA. I obviously am familiar with some of the trials and tribulations that the program has gone through. But beyond that, I don't really have a horse in the race at this point. I just don't know enough. I don't know what all the intricacies are of that. So I'm coming kind of in with a clean slate from that perspective. So I don't really have many more formal remarks. I didn't really prepare any formal remarks. I just wanted to express my interest again, as I discussed with you when I met with you before, that this is something that I would take very, very seriously, and I appreciate your consideration for me as a board member. Thanks.
Thank you. And the school?
My one son goes to SOC.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to work in reverse this time. So, Mr. Jackson, do you have a question for our candidates?
What does reverse mean?
That means we started with Mr. Haney before.
Got it. Well, first of all, thank you both for applying. Assuming you didn't live under a rock until yesterday, you know that there's a lot of work to be done here.
Yes.
Right? We got a lot of stuff to do. And I know that you've met with, you've done your interview with, your interviews with, with all the smart folks already, so they've already asked you a bunch of tricky questions.
Very tough questions,
I'm sure. but I believe in kind of giving people the good and the bad, the real look at what that's like. And so it's very difficult. This is a difficult chair to sit in because you show up with great intentions and you are committed to doing great things, but we still have sort of a long tail that we're still dealing with, right? So there's still, we're still paying for some things that have happened. And we're trying to separate ourselves from that, right? And take all the good that we've learned and move forward. But it's not just an easy thing to sit here and make good choices and talk about bonuses and raises and champagne popping and, you're right? There's some tricky things that come along with this. So I'm interested to hear about how both of you deal with really tough topics, really tough stuff, right? We're going to sit in here and talk about some very difficult things. And when we sit around this, you know, in closed session around this board table, we talk about some tough topics. And how do you guys imagine dealing with that?
I deal with tough topics every day. That's just my job. I'm a litigation consultant. I'm an officer of the court. I'm a receiver. I deal with entirely project-based issues. Each one of those projects has a different set of parameters. It has different personalities. It has different challenges. It's just part and parcel to who I am. I'm also, like I said, I'm a business owner. I deal with HR issues. I deal with IT issues. I deal with everything that comes with that. It's just, that just doesn't faze me. And I deal with hard issues on boards. I deal with having to one of the boards I sat on, the entire board blew up, and we lost. I forget what the count was exactly, but I think I shared this story with you gentlemen. We lost more than half the board, and we had to go through that and deal with some issues that fell out of that, and we had to rebuild it from almost nothing. And so I've been through that process before too. It just like I said, that I like challenges. I like dealing with those types of things, and I like doing them in a meaningful, constructive way that hopefully ends up in the best result for the organization.
Mr. Jackson, would you mind if I asked a follow-up to what he just said?
I hope you do.
Okay. This is different, right? If we're really going to be honest, this is going to be a different board experience than your previous, because this is now going to involve your family. So how do you find, I'm sure you've given some thought to this, so how do you think it will be a different experience for you now that it involves your family instead of other people's families?
That's a great question, and I don't know if I've given that particular thought. I guess the way I'm looking at it is if what's good for the organization is going to be good for my kids, and that's the only way that I can look at it. So I guess that I would have to remove myself from the emotional aspect and make hard decisions that at the time may or may not seem to connect as the best thing to my two boys. There might be something that's difficult to get through in order to make sure that OPA as an organization as a whole moves down the road and gets better and grows and does all the right things that it needs to do to continue to provide an excellent education.
Thank you. And Mrs. Trichet, you want to answer Mr. Jackson's original question? Do you need to have him restate it?
No.
Okay.
Well, thank goodness. Chase would have had to play it back.
Well, as a former educator, I think that's a great example. We deal with, you know, tough situation every day, and we still have to smile and pretend that everything is okay. And I can take a personal experience. A lot of you won't know that. 3 years ago, I was diagnosed with a tumor, and I was in front of the class when it happened. I mean, after I spoke to the doctor, I had to go back to class and teach. And
they really want to hear you on the other side.
Oh, okay. So I had to go back to class, pretend that everything was okay, and deal with the situation. At that time, my family didn't even know, my husband didn't even know the results yet of the test. And when I got home, I had two kids, so I have to be the mom and deal with it, which is a very tough situation. But the hardest part for me was going to bed every night and with the fear of not waking up, because that was one of the side effects. So for me,
it was hard to deal with, because how do you continue facing a challenging situation but act like you everything is okay? And I think sometimes in education or in your everyday life, it's the same thing. You're going to have to face tough decisions. You're going to have to manage things and do what's best for whatever, you know, the person, the organization, and at the end of the day, for your family as well. So I think, I know being a board member, I've been watching you guys, and I know what's going on. I know it's not easy, but at the end of the day, I'm also a strong believer of finding the common ground, you know, and what's right.
And I'll ask the same follow-up that I asked from Mr. Teeple. What do you expect? Do you have an expectation of how this experience, board experience, might be different based on the fact that it does affect family as opposed to possibly your other board experiences?
Yes, in the sense that this board is very invested. There's a lot of emotion sometimes involved in it because a lot of us are parents. And sometimes we, you know, we don't want to hear other parents express their, it's not that we don't want to hear other parents, but we might get affected by what other parents say or do. My experience with this, well, if I'm on the board, for me, it's an honor, first of all, because I like this organization, and which is the reason why I'm here. And even though my daughter is about to graduate, I want to be here because I see the result and I know what it's like to be part of OPA. And to answer your question, is it going to affect my family? Probably. My husband, that was his first question. If you're part of this board, what does that mean for me? In the sense that, do I have to worry about people asking me questions or whatever? And I'm like, well, I don't know, but I hope not. But I am very optimistic, and I'm looking forward for the challenge.
Thank you very much.
Both great answers. Thank you.
Mr. Diaz?
You know, we asked a lot of, maybe this is part of the report app, but we asked a lot of tough questions. We asked a lot of role-playing questions, what we do in you know, one scenario over another. We learned a lot about your background, your resumes, and more that was beyond the resume. So I was asked to come up with some additional questions for today. I was hoping to see if there was something that would be a follow-up, but
we had
some tough ones for you. So I'm okay for now. We had some great candidates, and you guys rose to the top. So thank you for being here.
Mr. Haney?
No one asked a follow-up question. When can you guys start? You guys got to give notice at your other boards or anything?
I actually do.
Priscilla and I each have a different kind of conflict. I'm a board member for Western Youth Services right now, and Western Youth Services is a vendor of OPA, and so that's a direct conflict. So I would have to resign from that board. And I've been on that board for, I'm actually disappointed about that aspect of it, because I've been on that board for about 7 years, and I think they just do incredible work.
Mm-hmm. Same thing. I would have to resign from Honor Society. Say.
Uh-oh.
And I'm pretty sure I'm going to have some very nasty feedback, but it's okay. I can handle it.
Okay.
Since I guess we're doing a bit of our report out now, I guess, on how it went, it was really humbling to actually to look through the resumes and then to actually sit down and meet the four people who ended up showing for interviews that were all, made me wonder how I got up here in front of you, because these were remarkable, remarkable people with great backgrounds. And sitting there asking them questions, I felt like it should have been reversed and they should have been asking us questions, because, I mean, really, I don't think we could have gone wrong. So, I mean, was very pleased to see the people who showed up. And I thank you for coming in on a Saturday and doing that. I thank you for coming now. I don't even know what time it is now, but being here as late as you are now, if you end up on the board, this would be an early night if we got out of here. So, I guess the additional question, I'm a lot like Albert. I think we covered a lot of questions on that Saturday, and neither of you ducked anything. You were very head on with both of them, and I appreciate that. I guess as I was trying to come up with a follow-up question for today, sometimes one of the hardest challenges we have here is how we perceive information. That something that seems black and white to us is seen differently by other members of the board. And I'm curious how each of you handle situations in which information that seems so obvious in one, when it's in your hand and you're figuring out what the course of action is, but then you find that other people that are involved in a decision-making process with you have a very different opinion of that information. And how do you go about processing that, reevaluating that, or communicating those scenarios?
Well, I can use the Honor Society, for example. We just recently voted and approved a policy, and people were like, what is that? We don't need this. And I read, even though I read the rules for them based on the nonprofit organization, we need to have this, we need to have that. Everybody was like, yeah, whatever, whatever. So some people understood why we had to have the policy in place and others didn't. So what I did, I basically print out the rule for them, showed it to them, guided through, you know, went through the steps, and then some of them had questions, so they answered the questions. And then from there, they were able, oh, okay, I didn't get it that way. I thought it was this way. So bottom line is you always have to make sure that people are on the same page. It's like when you're teaching, you have to make sure that all your students did understand what you're saying. You always have to go back to maybe the previous day, what, okay, that's what we said, that's what we did, how, who did understand, who did not understand, and make sure that everybody's on the same page. So you always have to make sure, have a discussion, or is it how you interpreted it? I don't know, Mr. Henney or Mrs. Garner, did you understand it the same way I did? And talk about it and then move from there.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's almost impossible to get into someone else's mind and see how they're gonna predict how they're gonna perceive something inevitably. If you're going to perceive it in a different way, how you go about resolving that type of conflict, I think when it comes down to it, it's being a little empathetic and trying to understand why you're having that disagreement and why they might be seeing it in some other way, and maybe refocusing on the information and see if that other person might have a point or might have a point of view that you're not considering. And see if you can kind of have a meeting of the minds that way.
Okay. That's all you. Okay.
Thank you very much for your willingness to serve. I speaking for myself, it's been one of the most challenging experiences of my life, and I've had a lot the past 16 months. Some of these meetings get quite difficult, but I will tell you every moment because it's for the children. So, and I think you both know that based on your histories, and I've looked at them very closely, you understand what it's all about. And I feel the same passion coming from you, and it's the passion that's going to carry you through those difficult times. But when I was asked to be on the board, it was right after FICMAT was published. Not an easy time to volunteer for a job. And I ended up saying yes, but it took me 60 days. And the reason why it took me 60 days is because I need to be assured that the three board members who are currently there, actually the four at that time, could do the hard work. Could they do the heavy lifting? Because they had to basically terminate the top executive administration, which was not an easy job. When I saw that they could do that, I said, okay, sign me up. I'll be part of that team, because that's exactly what we were. We were a team. So my question for you is, what qualities and attitudes and behaviors are you expecting from this board as your fellow board members? What are your expectations?
I think first and foremost for me is mutual respect, an ability to listen to the other person's viewpoint. Understand where they're coming from, why they're saying their things that they're doing, asking thoughtful and hard questions, and when you are going, and inevitably when you have disagreements, you work through those disagreements in a respectful and professional way. and realize that while you may not agree on one particular thing that that you're dealing with on your table at that given point in time, the big picture is what matters. So if you have to give a little bit here to get a little bit down the road and work through those kinds of concession processes, I think that's very important. But to me, it will always come back to that respect for one another, respecting the viewpoint, respecting where people are coming from, respecting their background, respecting that they are there for the same reason that you are there ultimately.
Thank you.
For me, I think most importantly, honesty.
Louder.
Okay. I cannot work with people that are not honest. That's something that has always been my motor, whatever you want to call it. I cannot deal with dishonesty. Integrity is another one. And as a language teacher, I'd like to work with people that are positively minded and who like to analyze things in different angles, because we all different, obviously. And at the end of the day, I will not leave until we come up with, like Mr. Jackson always tried to do, either a word or a solution or a promise that we will go back or discuss it and find a solution to it. So basically, respect, integrity, honesty, and collaboration.
Okay, thank you. Are there any other questions from the board?
Can I ask a follow-on question to yours? So, Sandra, and I don't know how Joseph and I slipped in. I really don't. When I look at your resumes, super impressive, both of you. Sandra asked me a question when I was standing at that podium, and she asked me about availability. She said, are you going to be able to take this on? Because this isn't, at that time, her and Sandra and Albert were meeting crazy. Remember, they were meeting like four times a month in special meetings all the time, and thankfully we're a lot better now. But there's still, this is a pretty good lift. And there's a lot of information to digest and that sort of thing. And I just, part of that, being sure that we're very candid with you about what the expectations are of a board mate. Are you ready for that? Right? You're ready to take on? There's big, deep issues that need to be digested. A lot of times, I mean, we'll receive literally 40-page documents from our legal staff about one topic, and there's three topics. So you have to, you know, read through that and show up informed and ready to ask good questions.
4 hours later.
Roger that. You guys comfortable with that?
I think we are.
We both are, yeah.
Okay.
That was one of Ms. Kathy's questions to us. Yes,
and I think we are definitely forewarned, because that came up in the interview, and it came up when we met with Kathleen earlier tonight, and you just brought it up again. So, you know, I appreciate you coming forward with that, but this is very important to Priscilla and I. So,
perfect. Thanks.
Do we have any other questions or any other report outs?
No, I think that. Unless you want to add something, I think we included our report out.
Now, I think it's fair to at least ask, do you have any questions of us? Have all of your questions to this point? Yeah, I'm sure you have a million questions that we can't answer. I know that. Anything that we can answer? Okay. We will be making this decision at our next meeting. So thank you so much.
On the 13th.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to move on to our consent agenda. I'm not going to pull this item. I simply want to highlight it, that on the consent agenda is moving our March meeting to March 13th, 2018, if you want to mark your calendars. And that's because we have interim budgets that we have to approve by the 15th. So that's in our consent agenda. So I just want to make sure that everybody's aware of it. So can I have a motion to approve the consent agenda, please?
I'll make a motion.
Okay, can I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All those opposed? Motion is carried. Okay, we're moving to items for discussion or action. Number one, participation agreement and resolution 2018-001 between Oxford Preparatory Academy and El Dorado SELPA. And the presenter is Dr. Lisa Hall.
Thank you very much. We are currently members of the El Dorado County Charter SELPA. That does allow us to operate as our own local education agencies. It allows us, and Chase has pulled up the El Dorado County Charter SELPA website for us so that you have a visual for what their front page of their website looks like, but they provide an array of services for us, and we have been assigned the same program specialist for the last 2 years because of a nice request. We had been given two different ones over 2 years, and then this year we got to keep the same one. So they provide us a number of services, allow us to operate as our own local education agency, allow us to hire our own special education service providers. And so they adopted a few new things in October. Therefore, we need to submit a new participation agreement. So what you have in your packets is the agreement for participation with the El Dorado Charter SELPA, and it outlines their recitals, their shared commitments. They read a lot like bylaws. They do ask that their members and partners are committed, that they have integrity, that they act with fairness, that they do see the El Dorado County Charter SELPA as a partnership, that we have knowledge of charter school law and practice, and they want transparency. So it's a good place. It's a good place to be. It provides the service that is required for us to be able to be our own local education agency. Our responsibilities are outlined within this document. Their promises are outlined within this document. And the fiduciary responsibilities that they have and that we have are outlined in this document. And if there are ever any types of disputes, if we disagree with something that they're passing down, how we resolve those disputes is outlined within this. And then it just indicates that we're agreeing to be part. So this agreement is entered into for the 2018-19 year, and absent a new agreement or termination, continues each year thereafter. So this is for next year. We do have one in place for this year, but this is a new resolution.
Okay, before we have any discussion, can I get a motion on the floor to approve the participation agreement and resolution 2018-001 between Oxford Preparatory Academy and El Dorado SELPA?
I'll make the motion.
Can I get a second?
I'll second.
Okay, is there any discussion?
Lisa, what's materially different between this document and the one that we have in place now?
That's a really great question, and it really has to do with the fiscal responsibilities, because the funding
theirs
changes.
Theirs or ours?
Both. Okay. Because fiscal responsibilities and the fiscal aspect of special education changes from year to year. So that's the most significant difference.
Any other questions? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Item number two, approve English learner policy. Mrs. Darty?
Yes. Part of what we're going to be doing over the next few meetings is reviewing and taking action to put updated policies in place. We are also missing several policies that are required by our charter authorizing authority and also by the state. So this is one of those policies. This is the education for English learners. Although we don't have more than 20 students that are English learners at this time, this policy will address the needs of those that we do have, and certain components of the policy are in place to address our numbers and our students if they should rise. Right now, we are not required to have what we call an ELAC committee because we don't have the 15%. However, things change rapidly year by year, so you never really know.
This policy is based on CSBA policy. This has also been vetted by our legal counsel, not necessarily for this school, but for another school that I got them to vet it for. And it has been approved by CCSA as well. So it's a nice blend of the charter world and the non-charter world.
And it has been reviewed by the advisory council with input from parents and staff?
Yes. Yes. Actually, we've rushed through this one. So thank you, SOC advisory council. They reviewed it yesterday, made a lot of edits, found all my errors. Thank you. And I made those corrections quickly, but also gave input onto some of the language. And then the SV admin also reviewed it and gave input.
Can I get a motion to approve the English learner policy?
I'll make a motion.
Can I get a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion?
Did any of the teachers or site leadership weigh in on these as well?
Site leadership from both sites weighed in, and teachers from the advisory council from SOC.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Item number 3, approve students with disabilities policy. Mrs. Darty?
Again, this is a policy that we don't have, we are supposed to have. Typically speaking, we adopt the policies from our SELPA. Our SELPA is El Dorado SELPA. But in addition, this policy outlines the specifics as required in Ed Code and required by federal code for students with disability and just law in general. This is based, again, off of CSBA policies, which is California School Boards Association, which is what the districts use when they develop their policies. And these get updated sometimes as often as twice a year, and some of them not for 10 years. But in this particular instance, we didn't have it. So this will be our first go-round with this policy, and it has all the necessary components to keep us in line with the expectation of our authorizer and with the law.
Can I get a motion to approve the student disabilities policy?
Motion to approve.
Can I get a second?
I'll second.
Okay, are there any questions?
Just a quick comment. When an organization doesn't have policies in place and then they make the big step of implementing a bunch of policies, one of the concerns is that they obligate themselves to a bunch of stuff.
Absolutely.
Reporting things and other things. And, budgeting, allocating funds, all that kind of stuff. And so I'm happy that in reading this, that there really isn't a big onerous commitment, more that it's a clarification piece.
No, and most policies don't necessarily obligate funds, but they do specify actions that need to be taken by the school or the admin or the support staff. And one of the things that I will be doing is I'm holding regular meetings with admin together, both jointly. They'll get tired of seeing me. But every time the board adopts policies, then I will sit down with admin and go through them item by item so that they know any changes that they need to work with their staff.
And then just so everybody knows, Kathleen's only here for how many days a month are you here?
10.
Only 10 days, but they're 24-hour days. She left that part out. Joseph caught her on that, so.
Yeah. We're getting a good deal.
We're getting a good deal.
Most of this looks like it's just a restatement of federal and state law.
It is.
To the extent any of this is discretionary?
The discretionary parts I adapted to what we have with the SELPA.
Okay. And the attorneys look this over as well?
Yeah.
Got it.
Our legal counsel they're not going to review this meeting, are they?
No.
They did at some point.
I just meant because they'll recognize their work for a different charter.
You charge us again?
Yeah. Where is it?
Okay.
It's right behind students with disabilities.
Okay.
No, that was discussion on disabilities?
Yep.
Okay. So we voted aye? We did the all in favor?
We're going to do that right now. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor of approving students with disability policy, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Item 4, approve updated identification and education under Section 504 policy.
And this was a policy that we actually had in place, but it was developed in 2013, and many of the laws and requirements have changed. So this policy now includes all of the updated laws, policies, and procedures that are required.
How often should we be reviewing these?
Anytime anything changes, we're supposed to review. I subscribe to an organization called Gamut Online, which is from CSBA, and they send out quarterly updates on laws that have changed, and then they tell you where in the policy it's changed, so you can make those recommendations.
So the expectation would be?
Anytime something's changed.
Right, but I mean, in terms of knowing that our new interim, our new executive director would have similar type resources at his or her disposal and keep us appraised when we need to update these?
Yeah, absolutely. That would be a necessary requirement.
We should add that to the job description. They need to know everything they need to know.
Yeah, please. Everything.
Aren't you involved in that as well?
Policy updates? I get updates from YMMC.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And we usually bring those to right. The executive director, the managing director.
Okay, so we do get updates from YMMC.
Okay.
And then I think they go to predominantly, is it you?
I get them, and usually the executive director or managing director both subscribe to those as well, so we get them all at the same time.
CCSA puts out quarterly updates, too, on which ones need to be reviewed.
And we've seen some of those come across.
Okay, can I get a motion to approve the updated identification and education under Section 504 policy?
I'll make that motion.
Can I get a second?
I'll second.
Okay, do we have any discussion?
How does this, so YouTubelandia, right? So we're doing this, we're streaming our meetings, which is great. And Chase is doing a great job, by the way, of being sure that everybody can see the documents that are being shared. And this is super helpful. But after, unless you watch it live, you're audio only month after, week after. And so is there a way for us to, I'm going to ask staff pretty please with sugar on top, if there's a way for us to figure out a way that we can store the video. And if that means that we have to transcribe the meetings, there's some great services on there that do it for 50 cents a minute or something like that that will transcribe meetings. And if there's a way for us to do it, because it really would be great to have the video available and that subtitle, right?
What we'll do is, with your permission, we will take a look and see what the ramifications are from a legal perspective and look at the cost involved and the time involved, and we'll bring that information back and we can make a discussion out of it.
Right. Done. Because when the board first made the decision to move toward video, we made the decision to make it audio only in the vault because of cost, because of the law changes can change rapidly on
right.
this.
So what we'll do is we'll do some research and bring it back for information, and you can have a discussion about it at that time.
Thank you, ma'am.
I think something else that could also address these concerns is making sure that all of our agenda and backup information is on our website.
That is occurring now.
And that occurs before the...
When we post the agenda.
Right.
We post all of these documents so that anyone... now or a year from now has access to those.
So I think that's really extremely important for our communities to know that, that you can actually pull those up prior to the meeting and follow the meeting with us with all the backup information, not just the agenda, but with all the backup material.
I did want to point out one more thing regarding the board policies. It is my intent before I leave this wonderful organization to set up a Google site to connect to our website that has a listing of all the policies, so you can search by keyword and the policy will come up, so it's easier to find.
You beat me to it. I was going to say you shared that with me.
I did share it with you.
And I thought it would be a good thing to share out. So all of these policies, you know, someone says, well, what's our bullying policy? That came up a couple of times, and it's like, oh, yeah, it's over here. What Kathleen's going to be putting together will allow the public to just let's go see what their policy is on this, that, or the other.
Yeah, I created it for my district already, so before I left, I moved the ownership to me and copied it, gave it back to them, and so now I can recreate that same site for anybody I work with, which is great, but it's really very effective and very helpful.
And that just as a matter of practice, when Rachel sends out the email that says, hey, there's a board meeting tomorrow or something in there, is there a link to the documents as well in the email?
I'm sorry, that was me.
No, that's okay. I've been keeping the page updated as they come through,
Got it.
Tonight. So if people thank you. Back to the page, refresh it, it might look different right now than it did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, maybe not 10 minutes ago, but certainly an hour ago.
Is there any other discussion? Questions? Okay, I have a motion on the floor. All those in favor of approving the updated identification and education under Section 504 policy, please say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. We're to the last item of the night. Approved chief business officer job description. I have two of you on this, so do I go to you first, or who do I go first? Okay, Dr. Lisa Hall.
I'm going to defer to Dr. Hall at this point. She took the lead on this one.
Okay.
There has been discussion about the need for someone with a finance and business background overseeing things internally. And so what we did was take a few job descriptions and combine them and look at our unique needs. So this job description outlines some of our unique needs and combines some finance aspects, while it also includes business aspects. So one thing that I will point out is that we don't have a plan at this time to not have a back office service provider. So this person is the primary liaison to our back office service provider. In addition, this person, this amazing person that's going to come on board, will facilitate and manage our participation in the National School Lunch Program. That's been quite the undertaking this year, and it will require some expertise. They will also serve as a financial advisor. The CalSTRS and CalPERS aspect reporting is an important component of the job. They'll assist with payroll and employee health and welfare benefits. When you look at the back of this job description, that's where qualifications are listed. And everyone's able to read, so I don't know how much you would like me to review this or
Talk about the new points that we put in the bottom half and the back.
As a result of law, we've included the working environment and the physical requirements for the job, and the salary is not identified, but it's commensurate with experience and education. So the person needs to be able to hear and speak, to exchange information. That's all outlined. And we don't discriminate on the basis of color, race, religion, ancestry, national origin. We are an equal opportunity employer.
We may bring this back for revision once we adopt a salary schedule, because right now we don't have one, so I couldn't put a salary schedule on there. But one of the things we've noted is that the working environment, physical requirements, and being a non-discriminatory organization was missing from all of our job descriptions. So we'll be updating all of them with that information and bringing them forward for your approval.
I have a couple of questions. At the bottom of the first page, assist human resource with payroll and employee health and welfare benefit procurement. So we have a director that's assisting human resources. What does that look
like? A chief business officer. So the
nobody they would report to him, or her.
Her,
right?
Not necessarily. Okay. So this person would help go out and get the bids for insurance to make sure that we're providing the best insurance we can provide at the best rates. So we have an excellent healthcare and benefits package at this time. So I don't know that that would be the most difficult aspect of this job.
Right.
But
I was just kind of looking at how does that work, you know, that
they work as a team to provide the comps, because the person who goes out to secure benefit quotes doesn't necessarily know how to take that data and extrapolate it over the cost of our personnel. Mm-hmm. So they have to work as a team.
Okay.
Do we need to make a motion to approve so we can have a discussion about this?
Do I have a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion.
Okay, do I have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, are there any other questions?
Are we under time constraint to adopt this now?
If we want to post the position, we do need a job description, so.
Did we get any input from Andy Stern on this?
On this job description?
Yeah, because he's got a 15, he knows us pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
And he's got, you know, 15 or 17 years as a business officer, so he might be able to really help us dial this in, knowing us and knowing what. So I just would like maybe have him take a pass at it.
Certainly.
If I can make a motion to say we would adopt this after he reviews it, can I do that?
You certainly can. I will tell you that I'm in contact with Andy consistently,
right.
And so we have discussed what the responsibilities of a CBO in this organization would be.
Okay, good.
That's partly why I wanted to point out that at this time we have no plan to bring our finances in-house. So this person is the primary liaison, and of course Andy's all for that.
Perfect. Yep. Okay.
The other thing I would like you to remember is that as positions change and requirements change, these job descriptions will change.
This is not purely a CFO type position, but should
this is not yet at all.
It's broader based than that, but mm-hmm. should the bachelor's be an accounting or finance degree, or is that just such a relatively small part of the job relative to everything else that's being done that it's not as important?
We could say it could be desirable.
Okay.
And an advanced degree would be more of an accounting kind of thing.
The difference, I think, is once you start putting requirements like that in, you're also significantly changing the beginning salary.
Well, there's a lot of operations parts on here, but I don't know if we want, maybe say accounting or finance might be preferred.
We could.
We can add.
Well, this is
I just want to point out that it says CBO certificate or completion of Access School Business Academy preferred, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, this is a C-level position, so this is pretty significant.
It is, yeah. But this is a very important position because this is the position that guides everything we do as far as expenditures and budget.
Now, one of the things that we discussed when Leadership Associates came and did their debrief with us or interview with us was the idea that whoever our candidate who ultimately comes in can build out his or her team. Is there a reason to approve this now? And they admitted that that can be a benefit to a candidate.
Yes, the superintendent is typically joined at the hip with a CFO, not necessarily the CBO, and there is benefit to that. But my only concern is that should we struggle with finding the perfect candidate, we are also going to lose time in having somebody that knows what they're doing guide us, and I believe we need that guidance. So I'm looking at it in terms of you need to get people on board. If nothing else, you need to approve the job description so that when the time comes, you can go for it.
So this would just be starting the process of gathering the resumes, and if there's a candidate in there who's a superstar that jumps out, we may be willing to compromise on the ED being able to build out his or her team,
right?
Because we don't want to lose a superstar.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And the administrative credential is preferred, not required.
That's correct.
All right.
You good there, Mr. Jackson?
I'm good.
Okay, does anyone else have any questions or comments? And they're part of the senior leadership team.
Yes, they are.
Okay. Okay. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Before we adjourn, I do want to point out, and this is Mrs. Daugherty's style of agendas, and I think it's an excellent idea. Future business before the board will always be at the bottom of the last page after adjournment so that you can see what the plan is, what's coming up next. Don't this can change. I want everybody to be aware of that. But, and certainly we will be adding to it. But this will let you know we need to get back to, and things that are on the radar, and things that we need to be talking about, and things that we're going to continue talking about. We didn't just bring it up tonight and it goes away. We're going to continue, like the salary certification and other issues like that, okay? Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Do we go to closed session?
We have closed session.
No, can I? Okay. Okay.
We have to go.
We are going back to closed session.
We're warned.
Yeah, so.
It's fair warning.
You can stick around if you want. If not, please leave the keys so that we can lock up for you. Okay? The time that we're going into closed session is?
9:01.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your patience. We're back in session at 10:56 p.m. We do have something to report out. During closed session, as part of the continued evaluation of all of our policies and procedures, on a 4-0 vote, the board is directing the interim executive director to move forward with evaluating site deans and chancellors. And one of my chancellors is nodding yes, so that's a good thing. Okay. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, now I'm going to ask for a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion.
A second.
Whoa.
Bye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Good night, everybody. Thank you.